Good morning to dear all participants. I am Dr. Prashant Patil, working as a head Department of Engineering Sciences at Sinhagad Institute of Technology, Lonavala. I welcome you on behalf of Sinhagad Technical Education Society, Pune, for today's session on career-oriented teaching learning. Today is the last session of Digitech Learning 2020 webinar series. Today's topic for discussion is career-oriented teaching learning. Now, in a career, discuss about the career and the definitions of career. So, let me explain the content for this discussion. Today's discussion is now divided into two parts. First part, that is we discuss about the career opportunities dilemma, how to make career decision, challenges in a career development, skill requirements to make a preferred choice career, either you can make good development in your chosen field of career. So, skill requirements. What are the career options available after 10th, after 12th, and career trends in this decade? So, first part, it is now based on career and career related aspects. Second part of discussion, that is reservation criteria for technical courses. What are the different types of scholarships, free seats available, either offered by government? Now, if somebody decided to make a career in a particular field, then how we as a teacher help them to provide sufficient information, that is based on totally learning style and teaching style. So what are the different learning styles? What are the different teaching styles you must have to adopt so that you can fulfill the requirement of the student? And now last, we will discuss about the teaching learning strategies, and now we in depth we discuss cooperative learning. Here, one cannot but must think about the future, because that is where you will spend the rest of your life. What are the definitions of career? If you refer to the dictionary, as per this Oxford Dictionary, the definition of career is what? A career is the work a person does. It is the sequence of job that an individual has carried out his or her working life. Second definition, the sequence of occupation, sequence of job, sequence of positions held during the course of life. And very simple definition, common definition of career is what? You can work in your interested field and enjoy life with sufficiently required money as a salary. So this is about the career. Now, dear friend, we live in a complex professional environment where one has to take care of the company's interest, individual interest, and family interest, and achieve the best of the career milestones. However, the majority of professionals don't have a clue about how to drive on their career path while protecting all these interests. And now that's why it is very essential first to discuss the factors affecting on choice of occupations or career paths. First factor, that is self-interest. So before deciding, either making choice for any career options, either you opted for any career, so self-interest is very interesting and very plays a very interesting and essential role. Now, if you don't have self-interest in a particular field, then you cannot make a proper career in your chosen field. So, self-interest is very, very essential. Now, for self-interest, one must have to identify, one must have to ask question himself. You should encourage to ask the question himself. And then by asking questions to yourself, you find out what you want to do, where you want to do, and after 10 years, 15 years, where you want to see yourself. So that is self-interest. Then second parameter is a very critical, that is also the parent wish. Because in most of the times, because of parent unfulfilled desire earlier, parents are also suggesting their wants, their kids can know, I was not able to make career in this field, so you please opted this profession as a career and you make your career in this field. So parent wish is also plays a very important role in a career path. Next is societal context. Because of society, we are living in a society Now we are living in a nearby our relatives, our friends, and based on that we can take decisions. If somebody's word is now make a career in engineering, then definitely such a discussions are going on in our home also. You know, now in engineering or in a medical, either any profession, that profession is a suitable, and now you make a career in that profession. So societal context, society pressure, relative pressure, family pressure is also playing a very vital role while making career. Then cultural influences. Cultural influences plays minor role in this making career options, but you cannot deny cultural influences also has certain limit, certain parameters, certain factors on making career options. Financial requirement. If somebody decided to make a career in a medical and unfortunately he or she is not getting good marks in a NEET examination, then there is no choice to go for good medical college. Then second option is now left, and that second option is what? That is, one can go for private non-aided colleges, but the fees for this medical for private non-aided colleges is much. It goes around 15 lakh to 20 lakh per annum. And then again some other expenses. So financial requirement is plays a very vital role while making career path, while choosing career path. So without knowing financial requirements, if somebody decided to make a career in a particular field, so all of a sudden he or she may get frustrated. And now last and very important, that is globalization and rapidly changing scenario in a job market opportunities. Because of globalization, job market scenario is now changing. Let us say ki early days, the job markets are now very high for mechanical and then electrical and some likewise. And now today, it now somehow diverted towards the IT and IT-based professionals. So globalization plays a very vital role while selecting, choosing career opportunities. How to make a career choice? Now, while making career choice, as we discussed, the parameters, factors affecting on this career choice. What's involved in a career choice? So there are four building blocks. They are again important while making career. So first you start thinking about your decision, my decision. Okay, so where I want to make a career. So thinking about my decision is the first priority. Then second, knowing how make I decision, what are the parameters I must have to consider while taking any decision. Now at the bottom, knowing about myself, where I am lacking, where I am strong, so you yourself identify much better than anyone else identify the skills and qualities lies in you. So knowing about myself is a very important. Again, knowing about options. Yes, if somebody wish to go for law, I want to make my career in a law. But now in a law, so many different kinds of categories of laws are there. For example, intellectual property rights, pharmaceutical related, you can say drug deliveries and drug related aspects. So, then, knowing about my options, let us say ki somebody is now decided to make a career in a law, then now in a law, intellectual property related rights, then international trade businesses, that cyber security laws. So what are the options are available in a law that you have to identify. So these four building blocks plays an important role, that is knowing yourself, knowing the options available to in a chosen field, then make a decision and start thinking decision. So while doing all these parameters, so first again interest, once you lies the interest, then you set the goal. Without goal you cannot make a all of a sudden ki yes, today I decided to make a career in a medical and all of a sudden I can get the admission in medical. No, that never happens. So first you have to decide, identify the interest lies within you, then you set the goals. Once you set the goals, then you start planning. Planning makes you to achieve the goals. Once you start planning, then you start preparation. Now it has been observed that, and now it is a very proven thing. If you decide, nothing can change. If you decide and determine, something can change. And if you decide, if you determine and dedicate all these three factors, three D factors, everything will change. So you start decide, you determine and you dedicate, that is, it comes in a preparation. Then preparation is again, then it is followed by education. Without education, you cannot prepare. And what, without preparation, you cannot plan. And without planning, you cannot achieve the goals. And now last two parameters, that is skills and salary. Yes, you can have academically, you are good, but you don't have the skill set. So while making career choice, you must have to think about the interest, goals, planning, preparation, education, skills, and salary. And don't forget to remember these four building blocks, what's involved in a career choice. These are very, very essential. Now, what are the steps for taking decision? Now, four steps already we discussed, but I'll just discuss about the interest. What do you like to do? Think about your experiences you enjoy. What kind of school, religious, social, or sports activities do you like? So based on that, you perform all these activities and then you will come up with, yes, my interest lies in this field. So these are the activities by using, you can find out the interest. Second goal, a career goal helps you focus on what you want to do for a living. It can be a specific job you want to do, such as a doctor or teacher, or it can be a particular field you want to work in, such as medicine or education. A career goal is based on your skills, your interest and possibilities. So goal. Now next parameter, that is skills. It determines the relationship between skills and interest and possible careers. And last one is the preparation. Familiarize yourself with the different paths and options for preparation. Once you decide any option, you selected, either opted any option, but first you must have to familiarize yourself, and then you must have to adopt certain changes, either certain paths and some sub options are there. So likewise, you can start preparation. So these are the activities helping you to take decision or to make any choice for career. What are the consequences of choice? If somebody is now decided to go for any particular field, but unfortunately that field is not his interested field, so you can say that is the wrong choice. If the person come up with the wrong choice, either placed in any job with the wrong choice, then frustration in workplace. He cannot perform well because he don't have that skill set, he don't have interest, and because of that he cannot fulfill the requirement of the jobs. So frustration in workplace leads to unemployment, worthlessness, feeling of rejection. Such a persons are always start feeling, you know, I am not suitable for this job, and these rejection feelings are start. And because of this rejection feeling, the person is always think about the persistent to desire to change the job. So no, I am not suitable for this job, I am interested to search some other job. So persistently he is now trying to change the job. And because of all these parameters, if the persons come up with the wrong choice, loss of confidence, and because of this loss of confidence, again it comes to the unemployment. Now other side, if the person identify all these parameters, interest, preparation, goals, and all education, academically strong, and now that is, you can say in short, right choice. If the person chosen failed with the right choice by doing all these methodologies, then such a person entered in a interested field, then match on without future regrets. He never bothered about, yes, I can be regretted by this profession, either I will be rejected by this profession, because his interested field he entered. So he is without any fear, he always match on future regrets. Now settled mind, joyful and desire to work. Because of this right choice and interested field, he is now settled mindset, and he very happily perform the duties and the tasks because of skill sets. So joyful desire to work. Now the person with the right choice accept challenges with the skills, because interest, skills, preparation, goals, because of all these parameters, he is now able to decide the right choice. That's why he is accepted challenges and now give solve these challenges with the skill sets. Such a person is efficient and effective, and because of this efficient and effective prosecution of work is always done. High productivity and last, high fulfillment and progress. And because of this right choice, the person, if entered in a chosen field with the right choice, he can enjoy the balanced life. Balanced life means he can enjoy his professional life as well as his personal life. Okay, so these are the consequences of choice. What are the challenges in career development? You have to rise up to the following challenges. Discover yourself. Now, while making decision, and now many times you listen in a Bollywood movie, their famous dialogue, Barkhurdar, dil se nahi dimag se kaam karo. But now while making career option, you must have to follow your heart, listen your heart, identify your interest. So for this, you must have to discover yourself. So without discovering yourself, you cannot make a career. Second parameter, challenge in a career development, that is prepare yourself well academically. If academically you are not good, sound, then you cannot again enter in a field. Collect sufficient information about proposed career. Because all of a sudden you entered in any profession and you don't know what are the current trends are there and what are the requirements, what are the skill sets are required. And now all of a sudden you start feeling rejection again. Okay, so the challenge is what in a career path? You must have to collect sufficient information time to time. Either you should be get acquainted with the changes occurs nearby in your chosen field. So in your proposed field, you must have to collect the required information, sufficient information. That information will provide you help, some confidence and some future projections. Yes, if you add certain things, so you can get career options in this way. So collect sufficient information. This is the challenge in career development. Develop soft skills, interpersonal skill, intrapersonal skills. Without skill sets, soft skill sets, so now that is verbal communication, written communication, then your gesture, your posture, and all these comes in the interpersonal and intrapersonal skills. Adopt changes which occurs frequently on career path. Now the best example, today we all are now locked down all of a sudden in homes because of this COVID-19 pandemic situation, and we as a teacher community, we are now familiar with the chalk and talk methodology. But because of this, schools and colleges are shut down. And now all of a sudden, immediately, we move from our traditional teaching methodology to online teaching methodology. So the person who wish to make a career very proficiently, then the person must have to adopt the changes which occurs frequently on a career path. If somebody is now says, no, I'm only interested in a chalk and board, I'm not interested in online teaching. So slowly, slowly the persons will be now out of the market. So adopt changes which occurs frequently on a career path is very essential. It doesn't mean I just acquired basic requirements of any job at initial stage and later on, I'm not interested to make any additions and changes, either some new technologies are coming, but I am only familiar with the old technologies, and with these old technologies, I will make my career. Sorry, dear friends, that era is already past. You have to adopt the changes which occur frequently. Now, next, viable and marketable. You should be viable, marketable. You should demonstrate your expertise and enough confidence. And last, professionalism. Because we are living in a complex world. Already I said. So values, interest and skills, these are the basic backbones again to make joyful career in a particular field. So these are the challenges in a career development. So skill requirements on this topic, for skill requirement, knowledge, application, problem solving, teamwork, communication skill, management, and the person should be globally competent. On these skills requirements and what are the attributes must one should have, already my colleague Dr. Mantri sir, Dr. Joshi, Dr. Manohar Chaudhary and Dr. D.D. Chaudhary, they discuss about the skill requirements. So I am not much interested to discuss about the skill requirements for jobs. Now moving to us next, that is RISC test. R stands for realistic jobs. So realistic jobs comes engineering, for example, pilot, architect, architecture, all these are the realistic job. Next, investigative jobs, technical, science people, engineers and science people, they are now doing this investigative job. So that is what medical research, teaching, teaching and physics, chemistry, then engineering, all comes in a technical sciences, and now that is nothing but the investigative jobs. Yeah, artistics, because society requires all type of profession, society requires all type of jobs, that is realistic, investigative, artistic. So artistic, creative and artistic professions. Then social, yes, social services, people oriented services. E for enterprising, business and sales oriented jobs. C, conventional jobs, hobbies based jobs, finance oriented jobs, banking, LIC, all these are the hobbies based, either conventional jobs. So while making career choice, you must have to identify the, either you go through this RISC test, and now you identify where I am interested, whether I am interested in a realistic, investigative, artistic, social, enterprising or conventional, and based on that, this math test will help you to identify and discover yourself. What are the career options? Now again, this slide is much familiar for everyone. After 12th, 10 plus 2 pattern, so many options are there, the pharmacy, engineering, then management, that is bachelor, bachelor in business administration, bachelor in computer application, then the traditional courses, BSc, MSc, commerce, arts, these are the career options. But I am interested to discuss about the career trends in this decade. We are living in 21st century and already two decades has been passed and we already entered in a third decade of this. Now, what are the catchy trends in this decade? And now that trends are blockchain technology. Dear friend, we all are now, you might be aware about this, Bitcoin cryptocurrency. Bitcoin cryptocurrency is one of the application of blockchain technology. Blockchain technology is a very huge topic and now this is the today's demand. So now in the next decade, either you can say in the present decade, blockchain technology offers a lot many jobs. Then next, machine learning, data science, data processing. Based on this data science and data processing, the Google is now operate today. Artificial intelligence is also one of the interesting job field, either career or profession. Cyber security, cyber laws, cloud computing. Today we are now producing huge data, huge data. Earlier we are now having 250 MB pen drives are sufficient to store your data, but today 1 TB hard disks are again not sufficient to store your data. So because we are producing lot many data, and now because of this we must have cloud computing. So for this decade, cloud computing attracts the good job. Next, that is electric vehicles. You all are again aware about this. Elon Musk, Tesla company, they are trying to make electric vehicles. Now presently, government of India is also promoting electric vehicles. So next decade is for electric vehicles. Next one is the genomics and proteomics. Next one is the virology. I don't have to speak much on this virology because we all are now facing this lockdown situation because of one virus. And now you might be aware that in Pune we have National Institute of Virology. So virology is the field where the person can make the career because the DNA, RNA sequencing of the viruses and modifications likewise. Next is pharmacovigilance. Today, because of this COVID-19, the whole world is now facing challenge. How fastly we develop the medicines so that we can control this COVID-19. So pharmacovigilance comes in data statistics. We required statistics, we required the computer persons, we required the pharma persons, we required the law persons. So pharmacovigilance is the multidisciplinary. Rather, I would like to say all these career trends which we are going to discuss, all trends requires multidisciplinary information, either multidisciplinary person. Next one is the bioengineering. Many colleges are now started bioengineering for engineering student as per the AICT, All India Council of Technical Education's guidelines, as per the guidelines of Human Resources Development, as per the guidelines of University Grant Commission, UGC. Though the person is now interested in computer engineering or mechanical, electrical engineering, either, but they must have to have certain basic information about the bioengineering. So bioengineering is again one of the catchy job, and we can get make a career, very happy career in bioengineering. Astronomical research, space research, nanotechnology, healthcare practitioners, environmental technologists. Greta Thunberg is now alone fighting to prevent this environment, green planet. So next decade, lot many jobs and openings are there in environmental technology. We required environmental technologists. We required management executives to manage the big project, big data, hospitality and catering professional. Because of this globalization and the traveling, we require some jobs openings are few jobs, not few you can say, rather you can say the lot many jobs are opening there in hospitality and catering professional. We required finance professional also. We required creative designers. And now the next decade is again for teachers community. Yes, these are the fields: blockchain, machine learning, hospitality, nanotechnology, space research. But whom you are going to provide all these information, all these knowledge? So teacher community is there. Teacher will help the student to make the career in this field. So teacher's job, teachers either career option, one should choose the teacher profession. So this is again in a demanding situation. So all these are the career trends in this decade. Now I would like to discuss about the admission eligibility for technical courses. Now I am now just discuss about the engineering. For engineering, the eligibility criteria is 12th science with physics, mathematics as a compulsory subject, along with any one of the following: chemistry or biotechnology or technical vocational courses. For open category, 50% marks in the above subjects taken together. For reserved category, by using physics, chemistry, mathematics, either omitting chemistry, taking any vocational subject, for reserved category, 45% marks in the above subject taken together. Score in joint entrance examination, JEE Mains 2020, in paper 1, either MST CET 2020, PCM, either PCM for engineering, conducted by the competent authority. And 20% seats are reserved for management. On the basis of, and these 20% seats are also filled by, based on fulfilling this eligibility criteria, for open 50%, for reservation 45%, and the student must have to appear for MST CET either JEE examination. So this is the eligibility criteria. Now how many institutes are offering technical courses, basically engineering, either BTech and BE? 342 institutes as far as concerned in Maharashtra. Now, what are the reservation criteria? So while making career option, you must have to identify, you must have to study all these parameters. So reservation criteria for all technical courses offered by government comes under this Department of Higher Education and Technical Education. So for scheduled caste, the 13% reservation is there. For scheduled tribes, 7%. Vimukta Jati, NTA, 3%. NTB category, 2.5%. NTC 3.5, NTD 2%, for other backward class 19%, and from last year again one more class is now added, that is SCBC, socially economically backward class. So this is the reservation criteria if somebody start to interested to go for any professional and technical course. What are the different scholarships and free seats are available? Now in previous slides we discussed, yes, I am interested to go for medical, but because of my financial situation does not support me to go for medical because I am having less marks in a NEET examination. But unfortunately, even today for medical courses, there is no such a scholarships available as per as concern my information. If somebody is having information, so you please pardon me. Scholarships and free seats facilities, I am talking about the technical courses for engineering, pharmacy, MCA, MBA. So these scholarships and free seats are offered by government. Percent of tuition fees approved by Shikshan Shulk Samiti, and based on that, for SC category 100% fee reimbursement is there, for ST 100% fees are reimbursement, VJNT 100%, SBC 100%. OBC and ACBC, you will get the 50% in total fees, 50% concession. Either you can say the 50% fee is now bear by government, EBC 50%, state government minorities is now offering 25,000, and PTC and STC are 4,000. All these facilities are available for those students who are admitted through CAPROUND. CAPROUND means centralized admission process, controlled and offered by Government of Maharashtra. The student, those who admitted through these CAP rounds, government rounds, only they can get, and they can get the, avail these scholarships and free seats. Now, seat distribution matrix also very important to make a career. For example, let us say a sanction intake is 60 for any particular course. Out of these 60, institute level 12 seats are reserved. That is, you can say management at the institute level. And CAP seats, centralized admission process, 48 seats are filled. Out of these 48 seats, all India reservation is there. That is, 9 seats are reserved out of 48 for all India, and 39 seats are offered for Maharashtra state candidates. Out of these 39, now through CAP round, 36 seats can be filled. Two seats are reserved for physically handicapped, and one is for defense personnel. Out of these 36 seats from Maharashtra state for home university, straightway 25 seats are reserved out of 36. What do we mean by this home university? For example, Pune University. Now, the jurisdiction of Savitribai Phule Pune University is associated, either it lies for three districts: Pune district, Nagar district, and Nasik district. The student, those who completed their 12th from these three district schools and junior colleges and interested to take admission in Pune region, either in Savitribai Phule Pune University Engineering Colleges. So 25 seats are reserved for this. Such students are called as home university student. And out of 36, 11 seats are reserved for other than home university. Other than home university is what? The student, those who belongs to other than these three districts, student interested to take admission in any of the college, either any of the course offered by Savitribai Phule Pune University, but he belongs to, for example, Nanded district, for example, Nagpur district. So interested to take admission in a SPPU Pune, then he goes in a other than home university category. So for other than home university category, there are 11 seats, and for home university, 25 seats are reserved. Out of these 25 seats, open category 13, reservation 12 seats are reserved. Again, open general seats are 9, for ladies reservation is 4. Likewise, this seat matrix. So what I would like to suggest, before making any options, before making choices to make a career in a chosen field, any particular field, you must have to study all these parameters. These are the very essential. Without knowing the scholarship, free seat distributions, eligibility criteria, you cannot all of a sudden get the admission. So this is prerequisite. Either previous informations you must have to collect and gathered, and based on that you can make a choice. Now, next is learning style and teaching style. Yes, so first part we discuss about the career, what are the options are there, and how one can make a career, and what are the factors affecting on making career choice, what are the different category or reservation criteria, likewise. Now, next part, next session, next part of this discussion is based on learning style and teaching style. Yes, of course. Now, we as a teacher, we will support student to make his career in his either her interested field. How? So by knowing learning styles, by knowing teaching style, and now based on that, certain recommendations are there for teachers, certain recommendations are there for tutor. Now, instruction begins when you, the teacher, learn from the learner. Put yourself in a place so that you understand what he learned and the way he understand it. What is the fact of life? What students learn is always less than what we teach. Second fact of life is again there. How much they learn is determined by their native ability, their background in the course topic, motivation for taking the course. Why he is interested to take this particular course, particular branch? Because certain motivations for taking course, certain motivations are there, and because of that he is understanding, he is listening this. And now next, match between their learning styles and your teaching style. So all these are the factors affecting, either you can have control over all these parameters. Now certain questions to be explored. What are the different ways a student take the information and process, that is learning style? And now we see this is learning style dimension. Which learning style are favored by most students? Which teaching style is favored by most of the teachers or professor? What are the consequences of mismatch between the teaching style and learning style? And what can we do to reach student with the full spectrum of learning style? So for learning dimensions, there are four learning style dimensions. First one is the preparation. Perception. Now in a perception, there are two types of learners comes in this perception style, that is sensing learner and intuitive learners. Sensor learners, either sensing learners, focused on external inputs. The person, the student, they see, they hear, they taste, they touch, they smell, sensing. They learn, they gather information based on sensing. Sensing learners are practical. Sensing learners are observant. They notice details of environment, and based on that means observer, they are good observer. They require concrete thinking. Either they must have this concrete thinking process. They love some facts, some data, some hands-on work. They learn through repetition, right? Drilling, for example. So drilling first time, he is not able to drill it properly. But by repetition, he can understand this. He can learn this. So drills, numerous example, replication of experiment. Sensing learners are methodical. Sensing learners, they like working in a group. But the problem associated with sensing learners, they start complaining about the course. The course is not apparent, course is not connected to the real world. So these are the problems, and these are the categories lies in a sensing learner. Now second category comes under this perception, that is intuitive learners. Now intuitive learners, they focused on internal inputs. For example, their learning is based on thoughts, their learning is based on memories, their learning is based on images. And now intuitive learners are imaginative learners. They look for meanings. They are abstract thinking. They love to understand the theories, math models. They like variety in learning experiences. They are bored with repetitions. But sensing learners, they love to repetition of the things. Intuitive learners, they are quick. They are like working with the concepts. But they start complaining. What are the problem is with the intuitive learners? That is, they start complaining about the course. Plug and check. What is plug and check? Loss of memorization, repetition, repetitive formulas, and now very popular word, that is rattama. So they start complaining because they are not familiar with this. They are not familiar with the learning style of, that is, we say plug and check. Now the problems with these intuitive learners is they are making careless mistakes in the examination. Intuitive learners, they are making careless mistakes in a test, in an examination. Whereas sensing learners, the problem with them, run out of time in examination. So this is learning style, perception. Perception is the first category. The student, they can perceive. And now in a perception, again, there are a subtle category, sensing learners and intuitive learners. Now second category, that is input modality. Now visual learners and verbal learners. Now visual learners, They ask you, show me something, show me pictures, show me diagrams, sketches, schematics, flowcharts, show me plots. So visual learners, they can understand the things based on their input modality. And input modality for visual learners is what? Show me something. Based on that, they can understand the concept. Verbal learners, their input modality is explain it to me. They ask you, sir, explain me. To explain me further, explain me in depth, in detail. So they love spoken words, written words, symbols, the same, but translated by brain into their oral equivalent. They see some pictures, they see some schematic flowcharts. Verbal learners, they can see it, but they can translate it by their oral equivalence. So this input modality, there are two types, visual learners and verbal learners. What is learning styles? Now in these two learning styles, visual learners and verbal learners and sensing and intuitive learners, bias dominance is there. You learn more when information is presented in your preferred modality, that is visual or verbal. Even more if you get in both. If you can make a mix-up of visual and verbal so that information can be communicated more efficiently. Most people are visual learners. 90 to 95% of the most course content is a verbal, that is lectures, reading. So our course content is verbal and most people are visual learners. And now this is the mismatch. And now as an effective communication, effective teacher, the teaching methodologies has to fill up this gap, fill up this mismatch. And then by considering certain teaching methodologies, you have to fulfill, you have to address the entire spectrum of the learner styles present in your class, whether it is visual learner, whether it is verbal or intuitive or sensing learner. Now next, that is learning style, that is processing. Active learners and reflective learners, it comes under the category of processing. Now these active learners, they tend to process actively, doing something physical with presented material, then reflecting on it. Active learners, they think out loud. Active learners, let's try it out and see how it goes, how it works. They actually perform this, tends to jump in prematurely. But the problem with these active learners is what? Without knowing much information, without collecting much information, prematurely they can enter in a field. Now active learners, they love to work in groups. Now we discuss the second type comes under this processing, that is reflective. Reflective learners tends to process, means thinking about presented material, thinking about doing something with it. Reflective learners work introspectively. They start thinking themselves and then they slowly they start learning. Now let's think it throughout and then try. First they think and they try. All of a sudden they cannot work immediately as the active learners without knowing they can jump prematurely. This case is not with the reflective learners. Reflective learners, they first think and then they try it. But the problems with reflective learners are what? Tend to delay starting. Now at early stage they are reluctant, they are always delay in starting, and now they like to work in a solo or pair work. Now all classes have both active and reflective learners, most classrooms are passive. Active learners don't get to act, reflective learners don't do much reflecting, and now this is the mismatch. Now being a teacher, we have to fulfill this gap and must have to address the mismatch. Last learning style, that is understanding. Sequential learners and global learners. Now for sequential learners build understanding in a local sequential steps. Sequential learners functions with particular understanding of information. They make steady progress. Sequential learners are steady progress. They explain easily. Now sequential learners are good at analytical thinking. Now global learners. Global learners absorb information randomly, then synthesize the big picture. They collect information randomly, and based on that random information, they synthesize it and then they form a big picture. Global learners need the big picture, that is interrelations, connections. They always try to find out the interrelations, some connections to other subjects and personal experience. They try to correlate this relation with their personal experiences. Either they try to correlate with the some other subjects in their course. In order to function with the information, why they need this? Because of to get certain information. Okay. Then global learners, large leaps is understanding with the little progress between them. They can't explain easily. Global learners, they are not good orators at the beginning. They can't explain it very easily. And global learners are synthesis. They are now master. They are strong in a synthesis and holistic thinking. And now this is the understanding parameters and learning style under this understanding. And now in understanding, there are two learning styles, sequential learners and global learners. Most students, instructors and course and curriculum, syllabus is designed in a sequence for sequential learners. That is not a mismatch. Yes, now in a 9 they learn first Newton's law, then now in a 10th, 11th, 12th, based on that they can start understanding how rocket launch by using F is equal to ma. So most of the students and instructors, teachers, course materials, curriculum, all are designed in a sequential manner. That is not a mismatch, my dear friend. But in a class, certain global learners are also there, though its percentage is very less. Now you say the global learners percentage comes in is a minority, but global learners are extremely important for society, for sustained growth. And because of this, sequential curriculum, course and the learning style, very slow and systematically, the global learners are weeded out from the class. And now this is very serious loss to the society. So all these four learning styles, and what are the consequences of style mismatch? Student don't understand. Now the student is visual learner and the content is verbal. So now mismatch is there. So student, they start boring in a class, inattentive in a class, either they start certain distractions in a class, disruptive in a mode, low attendance, bad grades, that is less marks in the examination, poor evaluations, discouragement about the course and themselves. They are not into, slowly they are now themselves, they are now find out, you know, I am not interested for this course, I am not made for this course, either this course is not suitable for me, because his learning style is different and we as a teacher giving them certain different teaching styles. Because of that, discouragement is there. Change curriculum. So because of all these, the student result, all these results, students now change the curriculum and now either drop out from the course. And now this is the very big loss for the society. Now for professors, mismatch, teaching style mismatch. The unresponsive, hostile classes, hostile in a class. All of a sudden faculty is now hostile in a class because of learning teaching style mismatch. Low attendance and grades, get defensive. The tutor is always in a defensive mode, blame student or question themselves. The tutor is now again discouraged, and now this is also the loss of society. Now see, because of this learning and teaching mismatch, students, because of that, students also slowly start removing their interest from the course, and teacher also removing his interest. And now in both the cases, that is the loss of society. Now summary. Now in a class, student may be sensors or intuitive learners, visual learners or verbal learners, active or reflective, or maybe sequential learners or global learners. Now being a teacher, all types needed in every profession, and that's why teacher or tutor must have to address all these learning styles present in a class. Now for teachers, Most teaching is abstract teaching, that is, intuitive learners like it. Most of the teaching is verbal learning. Most of the teaching and curriculum is sequential, and most classrooms are passive. We need to address all style, not just one. You don't address one learning style. You have to address for all four learning styles present in the class. Now, if you are now interested to address only one learning style in that type, teaching only in a less preferred mode, so that is insufficient learning result, weak in both the categories. Let us say reflective, either sequential and global learners, you are not fulfilling their requirement. Teaching only in a preferred mode, that is again imbalance. Strong in a preferred category, so preferred category they can grab it, but weak category they are not getting it properly. So what is the solution for this? The solution is what? Teach to both the side of each dimension, balance, strength. Okay, so this is the objective and of balanced teaching. Next, I am interested to suggest a few learning methodologies, teaching styles. So that is cooperative learning. This cooperative learning, the best answer to the question, what is the most effective method of teaching? The answer is what? It depends on the goal, it depends on the student, it depends on the content, it depends on the teacher. But the next best answer is what? If the student teaching other student, and now that is called as cooperative learning. And yesterday my colleague Dr. Manoj Chaudhary discussed a lot about this project and problem-based learning. This is something related to project and problem-based learning, that is cooperative learning. Now, you know, cooperative learning, it doesn't mean students sitting around a table and studying together. Cooperative learning, it doesn't mean groups, projects with one or two students doing in a group of project, in some assignment groups, only two, three students are performing and the whole group is now working. That is not the meaning of cooperative learning. Now, in a cooperative learning, positive interdependency, individual accountability, face-to-face interactions are always there, and appropriate use of interpersonal skill. So that is the beauty of cooperative learning. Now, at the beginning, you can make a teams in a group, make a teams in a class, assign, you can assign certain assignments to them. Sorry for interruption. Now for team homeworks, assignment done by teams, only names of participants on a final product, one grade per team, adjusted for individual performance, for problem sets, solutions outlined individually, complete by team. Now for team projects, now what I mean to say, let us say the class is now 60 students there in a class, so out of this 60, we have to frame out the groups. Let us say 6 groups are there, either 7 groups are there, and now you assign certain tasks. One group you can assign assignments, second group you can assign project, third group you can assign numericals based on that. So team projects. Second, projects that may be design projects, either may be performed in a lab, either in a class presentations done by the teams. Now specialized training provided for individual if the students allotted project, and one grade per team. Now you can allot certain grades to the team adjusted for individual performance. Now from experts groups, you provide some specialized training. And now at the some time after 1 month or 2 months, and now there must be regrouping in a home teams, and then you complete the assignments. Now peer feedback and structured controversy. So that is now again discussed by Dr. Chaudhary yesterday, how to form a groups and what should be the size of the group and what parameters you must have to think while making the groups. Benefits of cooperative learning. Now following things are improved in a cooperative learning. Student faculty and student interaction is improved. Information retention and grades are improved. Higher level thinking skills are improved. Attitudes towards subject and motivation to learn it. Teamwork, interpersonal skills are improved. Communication skills, understanding of professional environment, self-esteem, level of anxiety, race, gender relations are improved. So all these are the benefits of cooperative learning. Why it works? Because in a cooperative learning, the things are active and interactive learnings are there. Individual gets stuck up at any particular, let us say individual tasks are there. So person is now, the student is stuck up at any particular stage and now he is now giving up. But now in a group, if somebody is now stuck up at any particular stage, other members, they can helping them. So groups are always working. Students see and learn alternative strategies in a group. So many strategies they can identify, they can suggest, and based on that they learn alternative strategies. Okay. So because of that, this cooperative learning works. How to form this CL team? So again, I referred to discuss the yesterday's presentation. So three four persons in a team for most of the application form a formal CL teams. There must be a mixed ability level, common blocks of time to meet outside class. Second parameter to get ability, to maintain heterogeneity within the team. So there must be mixed groups. Forming CL teams, how to form these CL teams? First day, you can survey, ask students certain questions, their interests, their family backgrounds, their marks, their grades in a selected course, either the eligibility course, times not available during the work for group work. From groups, following given guidelines based on survey responses, you can take a survey. And then based on that, whatever groups you form, teams you have formed, that you can restructure, reform teams once during the course. During this course, you can reform. But remember one thing, self-selected teams are always better. So first, you can make a survey and then you ask students, okay, now you can form a group. If they are not able to form the group, then you interrupt, and then based on this survey, you can form a groups. Now, cooperative learning promotes positive interdependency. Make assignment challenging. If you are giving some one group, you are giving some assignment, so assignment must be challenging. Assign different roles. Now in a group, you can assign coordinator, you can assign checker, you can assign role for recorder, monitor, and likewise. And all these roles you can keep on rotating basis. Give bonus on test. If the student they are performing, then you can give them some points, 2-3 points, mark. Primarily individual testing. Now at initial phase, the tutor must have to identify their individual. Individually you can call them, randomly you can call them, and then you can start individual testing and call them randomly on team members to present or explain result. Peer rating of team citizenships. Now how to implement and what are the problems in implementing this cooperative learning? So student resistance. Normal when students are given unfamiliar things to do, and that is quite applicable for us also, then asked to take more responsibility for their learning. Second, minimize by helping them understand why you are doing it. So you have to, means teacher role is important here. Teacher now helping them to understand why you are doing this, because you connect it with the real world. Now you connect with the research base. Do midterm evaluation. So tutor must have to take some certain evaluation at midterm, and based on that you can identify whether he is progressing or not. Don't worry too much if a few student remains opposed or one or two groups don't work well at initial phase, but after certain 2 months, 3 months, either one semester passed, student those at initial phase who are now opposing for this cooperative learning, they will perform well and good. General suggestions for this cooperative learning: you start early, start small and build groups. Explain what you are doing and why. Mention benefits of this cooperative learning, particularly marks, grade, understanding, knowledge. Make assignments more challenging, but not necessarily longer. Now challenging means the questions are very tricky and very big questions. No, assignment should be challenging, but necessarily it should not be much longer. Don't curve your grades. Now first you start you decide evaluation criteria, rubrics, parameters, and all of a sudden you change it. Don't do this. Expect initial resistance from some students. Yes, it is anticipated at initial phase that some student in a class, they may resist, they are not interested to work in a cooperative learning, either in a groups. But accept this, anticipate this. Conduct a midterm assessment. If you are implementing cooperative learning well, very few students will oppose it after a month or less. And now that is the beauty of this cooperative learning. And now I'm going to wind up, and these are the references. From these references, I prepared this presentation. So Effective Teaching Workshop, Dr. Richard Fiedler, he is a PhD in chemical engineering, at North Carolina State University. Rebecca Brent is an educational therapist, president, education design sciences, working at North Carolina. And I referred one book, Rajaram Raubi, Mantras for Career Success. So these are the reference which, by using this, by assessing this, I prepared today's slide. So thank you, dear all participants, for patiently listening to me and bear with me. Now, today is the last session, and now is the time to vote of thanks. So this task is now again assigned to me. So it is honor and pleasure for me to say thanks, big thanks to all of you on behalf of Sinhagad Technical Education Society Pune, especially from Sinhagad Technical Campus. Our new technical webinar series will be shortly announced soon. So be connected with us and now stay at home, stay happy, stay healthy. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for your cooperation. Thanks for your keen interest to join this webinar series. And soon again, we are going to announce technical webinar series very shortly. Thank you. Thank you.
Sir, come for a time.